Welcome to the Chapter 4 lecture on Consumer and Producer Surplus. This chapter focuses on welfare economics. Allocation of resources refers to how much of each good is produced, which producers produce it, and which consumers consume it. Welfare economics studies how the allocation of resources affects economic well-being. First, we will look at the well-being of consumers, then we will look at the well-being of producers. Willingness to pay, or WTP for short, is the maximum amount a buyer is willing to pay for a good. Willingness to pay measures how much the buyer values a good. Here it is an example of four buyers' willingness to pay for an iPod. Anthony is willing to pay $250, Chad is willing to pay $175, Flea is willing to pay $300, and John is willing to pay $125. We can use willingness to pay to analyze demand. If the price of an iPod is $200, who will buy an iPod and what is the quantity demanded? Only those buyers whose willingness to pay is greater than $200 will buy the iPod. Therefore, Anthony and Flea will buy an iPod. Chad and John will not. Quantity demanded is 2 iPods when price is $200. Now let's derive the demand schedule using willingness to pay. When price is greater than $301, nobody will buy and quantity demanded is 0. When price is between $251 and $300, Flea will buy and quantity demanded is 1. When price is between $176 and $250, Anthony and Flea will buy and quantity demanded is 2. When price is between $126 and $175, Chad, Anthony, and Flea will buy and quantity demanded is 3. When price is below $125, John, Chad, Anthony, and Flea will buy, and quantity demanded is 4. Let's put this information on a diagram. Remember, price is always on the vertical axis, and quantity is on the horizontal axis. When price is above $301, quantity demanded is 0. When price is between $300 and $251, quantity demanded is 1. When price is between $250 and $176, quantity demanded is 2. When price is between $126 and $175, quantity demanded is 3. When price is below $125, quantity demanded is 4. Now this demand curve does not look like the demand curve from previous chapters. This demand curve looks more like a staircase. There are 4 steps, one for each of the buyers. If there were a huge number of buyers, as in competitive markets, there would be a huge number of tiny steps, and it would look more like a smooth curve. At any quantity, the height of the demand curve is the willingness to pay of the marginal buyer. The marginal buyer is the buyer who would leave the market if the price were any higher. Flea's willingness to pay is $300. Anthony's willingness to pay is $250, Chad's willingness to pay is $175, and John's willingness to pay is $125. Consumer surplus, or CS for short, is the amount a buyer is willing to pay minus the amount actually paid. The math formula is CS equals WTP minus P. Suppose that price equals $260. Flea's consumer surplus would be $300 minus $260, which equals $40. The other three buyers would not receive any consumer surplus since they do not buy an iPod at this price. Total consumer surplus would be $40. We can see Flea's consumer surplus on the diagram by shading the area above the price and below his willingness to pay. Now let's suppose the price of the iPod equals $220. Flea's consumer surplus would be $300 minus $220, which would equal $80. Anthony's consumer surplus would be $250 minus $220, which equals $30. Total consumer surplus is $110. The green shaded area represents consumer surplus. It is the area above the price and below the willingness to pay for both buyers. The lesson for these quick two examples we just covered is total consumer surplus equals the area under the demand curve above price from 0 to however many units are purchased. Now let's look at consumer surplus when we have many buyers in a smooth demand curve. Suppose we are analyzing the demand for shoes. Price per pair is measured on the vertical axis, and quantity, measured in thousands of pairs, is on the horizontal axis. The demand curve is smooth and downward sloping. At a quantity of 5,000, the marginal buyer is willing to pay $50 for a pair of shoes. Suppose the price of shoes is $30. Then his consumer surplus is $20. Consumer surplus is the area between the price and the demand curve from 0 to the quantity being sold. Remember, the area of a triangle equals 1/2 the base times the height. The height in this case is 60 minus 30, which equals 30. Consumer surplus equals 1/2 times 15 times 30, which equals $225. If price rises to 40, consumer surplus will change. Now consumer surplus equals 1/2 times 20 times 10, which equals 100. There are two reasons for the fall in consumer surplus. First, some buyers will leave the market since the price will be above their willingness to pay. Second, the remaining buyers have to pay a higher price, which decreases their individual consumer surpluses. Now let's discuss producer surplus. Cost is the value of everything a seller must give up to produce a good. In other costs, it is the opportunity cost. Cost includes the cost of all resources, including the value of the consumer's time, the seller's time. Here is an example of the cost three sellers in the lawn cutting business. Jack's cost is $10, Janet's cost is $20, and Christy's cost is $35. A seller will produce and sell the good or service only if the price exceeds his or her cost. Hence, cost is a measure of willingness to sell. We can derive the supply schedule from the cost data. When price is between $0 and $9, quantity supplied is 0. When price is between $10 and $19, quantity supplied is 1. When price is between $20 and $34, quantity supplied is 2. When price is above $35, quantity supplied is 3. We can transfer this information onto a diagram. As always, price is on the vertical axis and quantity is on the horizontal axis. When the price is between $0 and $9, quantity supplied is 9. When price is between $10 and $19, quantity supplied is 1. When price is between $20 and $34, quantity supplied is 2. When price is above $35, quantity supplied is 3. At each quantity, the height of the supply curve is the cost of the marginal seller. The marginal seller is the seller who would leave the market if the price were any lower. Jack's cost is $10. Janet's cost is $20, Christy's cost is $35. Producer surplus, or PS for short, is the amount a seller is paid minus the seller's cost. The math formula is PS minus costs. Suppose that price equals $25. Jack's producer surplus would be $15. Janet's producer surplus would be 5, and Chrissy would not have any producer surplus. Total producer surplus is $20 and is shown on the diagram by the blue shaded area. Total producer surplus is the area above the supply curve under the price from 0 to the quantity being produced. Let's look at the market for shoes with many sellers and a smooth supply curve. Price per shoe is on the vertical axis, and quantity measured in thousands of pairs is on the horizontal axis. Suppose that price equals $40 for each pair of shoes. At a quantity of $15,000, the marginal seller's cost is $30, and her producer surplus is $10. Producer surplus is the area between price and the supply curve from zero to the quantity being produced. The height of this triangle is 25, 40 minus 15. Producer surplus is 1/2 times $25 times 25, which equals $312.50. If price falls to $30, producer surplus would be 1/2 times 15 times 15, which equals $112.50. There are two reasons for the fall in producer surplus. First, some sellers will leave the market since the price will no longer exceed their cost. Second, the remaining sellers will receive less producer surplus due to the lower price. Consumer surplus equals the value to buyers minus the amount paid to buyers. In other words, it's the buyer's gain from participating in the market. Producer surplus is the amount received by sellers minus the cost to sellers. In other words, it's the seller's gain from participating in the market. Total surplus is the sum of consumer and producer surplus. It is the total gains from trade in the market. In other words, it's the value to buyers minus the cost to sellers.